What if one town created 16 serial killers, and it was one man's job to figure out why? Welcome to the Comic Storian channel, where I take your favorite comic book single issues and trade paperbacks, and I break them down into digestible bites. I give you a synopsis of the storyline, allowing you to understand what is going on, and kind of get a better idea of some of the comic books that you too can go out and buy. You can buy this issue and get more context, or go buy Volume 2 and understand what happened in Volume 1. All alterations of the panels, text, and images are to prevent copyright problems, and all art is owned by its respective companies. Today we're going to be covering a special book, an independent book from Image Studios written by Joshua Williamson, Nailbiter. This is Volume 1, and if you enjoy it, make sure you join the Comic Storian Army by pressing that bell, turning on notifications, so that you know when I cover Part 2. Now let's get into the Nailbiter storyline. There was a phenomenon that started 3 years ago in Riverside, California, or at least when it was given a name. FBI agent Elliot Carroll and his team managed to capture Edward Charles Ward, the 16th Buckaroo Butcher, who was known as Nailbiter. He would kidnap men and women who had a habit of biting their fingernails. He would let them grow back, and he'd chew their fingers down to the bone before ultimately killing them. He was suspected of 46 deaths. But 3 years later, Agent Nicholas Finch finds himself alone in his home in San Antonio, Texas, holding a gun to his head. And as he's about to pull the trigger, he gets a call from Carroll telling him that he did it. Get on a flight to Buckaroo, Oregon, now. Finch asks what is he talking about, and Carroll says, the Buckaroo Butchers. He cracked the secret, but he needs him here. Finch pauses for a second, stating that it isn't really his expertise, but Carroll tells him that his trial doesn't stop for another 9 weeks. Besides, he's the only one that can be trusted. The next day, Finch flies out to Buckaroo and waits for Carroll to pick him up as he thinks back to his trial and the events that led up to it. But before he could dwell, a young girl passes him, telling him that he shouldn't chew his fingernails here. The people around him are getting a bit nervous seeing him do that. He tells her, right. But when he looks over, he asks, is that what he thinks it is? She tells him, yep. Wait until he meets the old creepy guy who runs the murder store. Finch walks into the dark and ominous store, looking at all of the oddities when suddenly a man throws his arm around him, yelling, howdy! Allow me to give you a proper tour of the world's first serial killer souvenir shop. My name is Riley Woods, and if you're a fan of Gruesome and the Macabre, the murder store is the right place. In fact, the mask that you are looking at is a replica of the very mask worn by the infamous Book Burner. He was picked on for his inability to read, and Finch tells him that he knows the story. Doesn't he think it's a bit insensitive to gain from this? Riley tells him his grandfather, Norman Woods, was the Book Burner. Ruined their good family name. Can't hurt to try and turn a negative into a positive, right? My next goal is to get a horror convention here. Gonna call it KillerCon. Before Finch could even say how disgusting that is, he and Riley hear the young girl from before shouting. They look outside and they see some of the town kids, Hank and Robbie, telling the girl Alice to come on and get a little closer to them. Hank grabs her, but Alice kicks him in the groin and then claws at Robbie's face to keep them away. Finch manages to jump in the middle, telling everyone, all right, this is over. And as Hank gets up, Finch says that he has two rules. One, no women. And how old are you? Hank yells 21, but Finch quickly tells him that he is lying. Hank then says 18. All right, number two, no kids. And he punches Hank. As Hank jumps back up asking, do you know who my dad is? Finch gets ready to swing again, telling him, nope, and I don't care. Just then, Sheriff Crane pulls her gun, yelling, hey, mind not beating on my citizens? And after clearing everyone out, Finch asks if everyone here is this pleasant. She tells him that the new people that come strolling through are usually reporters looking for a bit of a score, or a cop looking for a big score, which is he. Finch takes out his badge, telling her that he is Officer Nicholas Finch, Army Intelligence, and he is looking for his friend, Elliot Carroll. Crane tells him, well, he should probably come with her then. She brings him to Carroll's turned-over motel room, stating that she and Carroll would get coffee every Monday since coming to town and never missed a day. When he didn't show, she got worried and was on her way to the station to report it in when she ran into him. Finch says that he assumes that she knows what he is here for, and Crane tells him that it's all he ever talked about. He was obsessed with finding a connection between the Buckaroo Butchers. Swore that there was no way that 16 serial killers born in their small town was a coincidence. Finch says that he got a call yesterday from him stating that he pieced it together. You have any problems with anyone? She tells him, aside from the obvious, no. Everyone thought that he was a good guy. And when Finch asked about the obvious, she asked, who does he think? The two drive out and Finch asks, after he was acquitted, he just came home? And Crane says, yep, can't trust a jury to do anything right these days. He moved into his old parents' home like nothing happened. Soon the two arrive at their destination and Crane knocks on the door of the old wooden house. A man opens it, stating, I have a roast in the oven. I wasn't expecting visitors today, but don't worry, there's enough for everyone. As Warren leans against the doorframe, he starts to bite his thumbnail, holding a bloody meat cleaver. As they walk in, Warren goes back to cooking and Crane asks, when was the last time you saw Carol? You know, here and there. It's a small town, but yesterday for our weekly lunch date. Carol was determined to figure out why 16 of the world's worst serial killers were all born in our lovely little burb. An obsession, really. You can check with the sheriff stationed outside. Carol came and left alive. So Finch asks, what's with the blood then? It's just a bit of meat juice from the barn. I can take you out there if you'd like. I slaughter them myself in my own special way. It's a nice release. At that moment, Finch throws Warren out from the barn, stating, we're wasting time. This man is a serial killer. We all know it. The whole damn world knows it. Just because he was acquitted doesn't mean anything. At that moment, the dispatch radios in that they need Crane back in the town. They have a 1070. As they leave, Finch says that a 1070 is a fire. They both race back into the town to find Carol's motel building on fire. But before waiting for the fire department to come in, Finch just runs in. He needs to get Carol's notes. He needs to know what is going on. He pushes through the burning door, finding the files hardly damaged, grabbing them. But then he hears something fall over in the bathroom. He kicks it open to find a body slumped to the ground, burning. A bit of time passes as the fire department arrives, and Crane says that she needs to know. Carol figures out the secret to the 16 serial killers, and the only person that he calls is him. Why? What exactly does Finch do for Army Intelligence? Information Extraction Specialist. And that's a fancy way of saying what, Finch? He takes a moment and tells her, I interrogate and torture people for info. Used to, at least. Carol knew that I would help him find out who's lying. That I could be trusted. Meanwhile, over in the cemetery, Hank pulls off the book burner mask, asking, what the hell? We set the motel on fire to cover their tracks. No one said anything about a body being found in there. This is getting to... But before he could finish, a figure cuts his face and Hank stumbles back. He tries to call for help, but the figure gets closer, raising their knife and... We then cut back to Finch and Crane grabbing something to eat as they're going over the notes. But Morty the Mortician calls, telling Crane that he had a chance to look at the body and they're not going to believe who it is. They step out of the diner, beginning to go to their car, but that's when they look over at Raleigh's murder shop and they find a dead Hank strung up on a sign. And they notice something odd about him. His fingers. They look like they've been chewed off. The scene is blocked off and one of Crane's sheriffs yell that they have a problem. Some folks heard about Hank's fingers and they headed over to Warren's place. They're gonna hang the man. Crane heads over to Warren's place only to find a man with a rope and a Warren being suspended. The masked men who did it hear the engine revving and suddenly Crane crashes a car into the tree to free Warren. All of the men begin to spread out and run with Crane yelling that don't think that she doesn't recognize them. Expect a visit later. As Warren is now freed, he begins to cough, stating that he never thought he'd be thanking her for saving his life. But she tells him not to thank her, as she hauls him off and locks him up for his own protection. With that taken care of, Crane takes Finch over to the mortician. Finch asks what his real name is, because Morty scoffs, telling him it's just some dry gallows humor. His real name is Garth Diggins. Finch tells him that Diggins sounds familiar, and Morty explains that his uncle was one of the Buckaroo Butchers. It's a small town. But as he begins to say the word town, the lights begin to flicker. It's quickly dismissed as being an outdated electrical system and they head over to the examination room. Morty begins by telling them that Hank's fingers were not chewed off. They were ripped apart by pliers or something. And he was killed by multiple stab wounds. Not Warren's MO. The other thing that he wanted to explain is that the body that they found in the burning motel isn't their friend. The level of decomp shows the body has been dead for a long time. And the body is the body of the book burner serial killer. But the question is, why was his body there? And then through the flickering lights, a hooded man sneaks in with a knife. Finch thinks about it, still not noticing the masked man, that maybe they should call Carol's phone. And at that moment, a phone begins to ring in the hooded man's pocket. But before he could stab Morty, Finch tackles him, pushing Morty out of the way. Crane begins to chase after the hooded man, and as she grabs the hood, the man slips out the door without a trace. Short while later at the cemetery, Finch says that it was the Y2K killer. Killed as many teenagers as he could before midnight at the turn of the century. But he didn't kill himself when the world ended, and why did he have Carol's phone? Crane goes to her trunk, stating that that's why they're here, to get answers. This cemetery has a special section, just for the Buckaroo Butchers. If that really was the book burner's body, what's in his grave? The two begin to dig into the graveyard itself, with Crane wiping her brow, asking if he's ever going to talk about his job. Why did Carol call Finch out? Finch tries to shrug it off, telling her that he gets the truth out of people. Carol knew that and wanted his help, but Crane says, "What, you have nothing better to do?" Finch tells her, "Funny story. Actually, he was." As Finch held up his shovel, he inadvertently deflected a bullet. They jump down into the grave, with Finch asking if she can give him some kind of cover. Crane pops up, firing in the direction of the shooter as Finch makes a dash for it. He looks around, unable to find the killer, really getting sick of the town, but at that moment, the Y2K killer jumps out of the bushes. Finch spins back, punching, stating, "I ain't gonna go down that easy!" And as they struggle, Finch pushes the killer back, asking for help. Crane says that she was waiting on some distance. Now, she then opens fire, but the killer turns back, starting to shoot, giving himself some cover. Crane dunks into the woods while the killer focuses on Finch, but then she begins to run out the other side, tackling the Y2K killer, knocking his gun away. She shouts that they're going to find out just who, and as she pulls the mask off, Robbie begins to cry, telling her that he is sorry. He didn't mean for any of this. He didn't kill Hank. They just burned the motel. They were supposed to scare people away. They told them. They told them that there would be no more killers, that they would fix the curse. Crane lowers her gun. "Who told you this?" And Robbie says that he can't tell her. He did it for the town. At that moment, Robbie points the gun to his own head, and he pulls the trigger. Finch sits up from the grave, stating that the kid was telling the truth, or at least he believed that he was. Aside from that, there's something else. This grave that they've been digging, there's nothing there. There was never a coffin in there. It was just a hole filled with dirt, and at that moment, the wood plank that he's standing on gives way, and Finch falls into an underground tunnel that looks like cells. Crane yells that she'll get him a rope and be down there in a sec, but Finch looks around. No, 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 no. Crane gets down, asking what is going on, but as she turns, she sees Carol. His arms and his legs have been cut off, leaving only a torso. She shines a light on him, asking if he's dead. But as she gets closer, he tries to scream, but his mouth has been sewn shut. Later at the hospital, the doctor says that Carol is lucky to even be alive. His condition is remarkable. They just found him in the grass, and Crane says, "Yep, in the grass." The doctor says, "Right. We'll need to run some tests and get them back to you." But as the doctor leaves, Finch whispers that she lied. She tells him that they need to keep those caves between them until they figure out what they are. So he asks, "You've got a plan now? How about we go talk to our fingernail chewer buddy and let him know the good news?" They arrive at the station and Warren sits up in his cell. "And then I laid out the black garbage bags and..." Crane turns the corner asking, "Are you kidding, Alice? What the hell are you doing talking to a known serial killer? Get the hell out of here." After blowing Crane off, Crane looks back at Warren, telling him, "You're free to go. I was only holding you for your protection, but I don't feel like that's doing it anymore." Warren waves them off. "Fine, fine. I have to go pay a visit to old Raleigh anyway. Toodles." While Finch and Crane follow up on Robbie's room for any more clues, they happen to find a mask and they ask themselves, where could he have gotten it? And then they remember what Warren said. He was going to go see Raleigh. Later at the murder store, Raleigh tells a mysterious figure that he isn't going to have those boys' deaths on his conscience. That wasn't a part of the deal. Drumming up interest in the Buckaroo Butchers is all that he signed up for, but now it's gone too far. "Who the hell dug up my granddaddy's body, huh? Was it you?" The figure pulls his hand out of his pocket and strikes a match. Raleigh steps back, stating, "Now hang on a minute, no need for that." But just down the street, Finch and Crane speed up, coming to a screeching halt as they pull up in front of the murder store. They see smoke coming out of the door, and Finch kicks it open as he and Crane see a shadowy figure with a horned helmet wielding two swords and the torn apart body of Raleigh at their feet. The figure lunges at them and the two take out their guns, firing, putting enough bullets in them to finally knock them down. And while taking a moment to process everything, Finch and Crane turn their backs when the figure sits up, pushing a shelf on top of them. Now with them trapped, the killer walks up, scraping their swords together until they're just in range to stab them. But suddenly, Warren jumps on the killer's body, slamming him into a wall, telling him, Did people really think that this was me? As the two stumble out, Warren gets up stating, "So we meet again. You don't call, you don't write. Began to think that you were leaving town. But it's not like you to make such a grand entrance. What's the deal? Why now?" The figure points back at Finch and Crane, and Warren asks, "What about her? You think I'd save her and let you walk away?" And after a few moments of silence, Warren does walk over, lifting the shelf, letting the killer walk away. Once the three are out, Crane asks what the hell is he doing here, and Warren says that he was actually a silent partner in Raleigh's store. But Raleigh was trying to screw him out of his investment, so he wanted to have a chat. Anyway, maybe people can stop shining a light on me for once. The next day, Finch and Crane go to take another look at Carol's notes, when Crane decides to get them coffee. She steps out of Carol's room and a well-dressed woman walks up. "Sheriff Crane, my name is Agent Abigail Barker. I'm here about Elliot Carroll." Crane says that she figured the Bureau would send someone, but they have Carroll right here. He just isn't in good shape. Abigail goes on explaining that from this point on, she'll take over the investigation of Carroll's disappearance. She hopes that they can— Jesus Christ, is that Nicholas Finch? Crane says, "Yeah, you know him?" And Abigail says that she does, but he shouldn't be here. He's supposed to be on trial for murder. Meanwhile, elsewhere, Alice heads down into her basement, turning on the lights. And as the light shows news articles, they are all about the Buckaroo Butchers and their birthplaces. She taps her foot, stating, "If I were a serial killer, who would I kill next?" And there you have it, chapter one of a nice horror serial killer storyline right here at Comic Story. And if you guys enjoy this, I want to keep doing it. I want to keep bringing you Nailbiter. So if you want more of this, make sure you press that bell, turning on notifications so you know when the next episode comes out. I'll probably do it in the next week or two, so you're definitely going to want to know when that is. Also, join the Comic Story Army by pressing that subscribe button and clicking like and joining us right here at this channel as we bring you 2 to 5 videos a week telling you all kinds of stories within the world of comics. Thank you guys so much for your continued support. Let me know what you think about Nailbiter down below, and I'll see you next time right here at the Comic Storian channel.